Thomas Sowell explained visually, inflation is a hidden tax. Drawn from the book Basic Economics. If you don't want to stick around for the entire video, then here is the basic gist of it. Inflation is a hidden tax. We all know that taxes is a way that the government steals your money. Look, if you don't think that taxes is the government stealing your money, then you're probably not the type of person that likes these videos. Inflation is another way that the government steals your money or steals your wealth. We're also going to talk about war. War is very expensive, and the government has two options. Hey, we can pay for this war through taxes, or we can just print a bunch of money to pay for the war. And when you print a bunch of money, you create inflation, and inflation is a hidden tax. It's another way that they steal your money. We're going to talk more about that. John Maynard Keynes, by a continuing book. First of all, Thomas Sowell is from the Chicago School of Economics, which is at the polar opposite end of the Keynesian view on economics. So when Thomas Sowell is quoting John Maynard Keynes, we know it's getting real. By continuing process of inflation, governments can confiscate secretly and unobserved an important part of the wealth of their citizens. I'll translate that in a little bit, but I think you get an idea of what's going on. So if we look at 1960, a dollar bought six times more stuff. A $1 bill was six times more valuable. Basically, if we just want to put it into our easy brain, a dollar was like $6. Or a dollar could buy six bags of chips, whereas today it only buys one bag of chips. 1960, it bought six times more stuff. Or you can reverse it and say, today a dollar buys six times less stuff. And that's because of inflation, which is the government printing a bunch of money, which causes prices to increase or takes away purchasing power. Again, if we want to look at it another way, 1960, imagine you put $6 in the bank, and then you go back to the bank 60 years later for whatever reason, and then you get $1 out. Now, it's a bit of an exaggeration, but I'm just trying to give you the idea of what's happening with inflation, or from Thomas Sowell saying that, you know, the buying power of the dollar is six times less. So this is just a graphic representation of the buying power is six times less. Now, yes, I know you still, if you went to the bank, they're going to give you $6, but it's just easier to represent that way. So yes, you do get $6 back, but $6 buys less now. It buys what $1 bought in 1960. The money didn't disappear. It's just that prices rose. And the prices rose because supply has led to an increase in prices because supply dropped. Or demand, which is increased because the government printed more money. When people have more money, they tend to spend more money. When they spend more money, that drives demand up. And demand goes up, so do prices. And that's really what inflation is. It's just the general increase of prices over time. That's all. And it's created by printing more money. So, I mean, just another representation, a dollar could buy six. You don't really need to worry about all this. I'm just trying to get you the idea that it has six times less purchasing power. That's all you really need to know. 1962 to today, a dollar has less purchasing power, and that's because they've printed too much money. Buy six times less stuff. The purchasing power. Now, don't get hung up on the numbers, because you start thinking about, well, six bags of chips, and if I had a dollar, then I have a dollar. Don't get hung up on that. It'll drive you crazy. Just know, because of inflation, prices have gone up. Or you can look at it as the purchasing power of the dollar has decreased. It's the same thing. Both of those are the same thing. But don't get hung up on the numbers of, well, if I had that money then, and I got this, then that. Stop. Just know that, one, prices have gone up. That's inflation. The general rise in prices, because they printed more money, that created more demand, and more demand drives the prices up. Or that you can just look at it as the dollar buys less. It's the same thing. So I'm not going to spend any more time on that. What I really want to talk about is inflation as a hidden tax. Not so much on what inflation is. There's another video where we talk about inflation where Thomas Sowell, in one paragraph, knocks it out of the park. Today I want to talk about is inflation is a hidden tax. When the government prints more money, that means people have more money, they spend more money, and when they spend more money, that's an increase in demand. And as we know, when demand increases, prices go up. That's an example of inflation. We're also, in this video, going to give you an example of supply decreasing as well. So not only do we have an increase in demand because of the printing of money, but we also have a supply decrease, which also drives prices up. So let's bring in the government and create this whole mess. Taxes are a way the government steals your money. I'm sorry, there's no other way of looking at it. Look, if you want to love the government, that's fine, but the government is taking your money and you have no choice. Give me another example where someone takes your money and you have no choice. All those other options or all those other scenarios or examples will be called theft. But they provide, oh, okay, just play with me, okay? Play the game. We know that when the government taxes us, most voters and citizens are not happy. We do not like higher taxes because it's theft. It's theft. You don't like high taxes. You don't. You don't want to pay more in taxes because you realize what it is, although you don't want to admit it. So just admit it. You don't even have to play. Just admit it. You don't like the government raising taxes. Most voters don't like raising taxes. You don't want them to take your hard-earned money. Politicians know that. Politicians realize if I raise taxes, they're not going to vote for me. So politicians often decide, yeah, we're not going to raise taxes. That's a problem. Yes, I'll vote for you if you don't raise my taxes. Cool deal. There's a problem. Government got bills to pay. The government's got to pay for all the services that they provide. Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, defense. They have to pay for these services that they have promised you. And if they're not going to tax you, where will they get this money? Where can they get the money to pay for all these services? They can't tax you because then they won't get voted. But they've got to pay for all these services. So what they do is print money. And this is a hidden tax. This is a way that they also confiscate your money to pay for the services. We don't think about it this way. We don't. We don't comprehend this. They know what they're doing. They are lying to us. This is a secret tax they use to pay for all these goods and services. Today, we'll focus mainly on defense, not to pick on defense, but this is a big issue. This is a very big expense. This is something that they've had to pay for, and they've paid for it by secretly stealing your money. War is expensive. John Maynard Keynes again. Sowell must be getting serious if he's quoting the enemy. There is no record of a prolonged war or a great societal upheaval which has not been accompanied by a change in the legal tender. But almost unbroken chronicle in every country which has a history, back to the earliest dawn of economic record of a progressive deterioration in the real value of the successive legal tender which have represented money. So basically every war that has ever happened has also existed with inflation or a deterioration of the value of those dollar bills. That's Keynes saying that. War is expensive. You know this. And taxes seem like the best way to pay for it, or at least the most honest way to pay for a war. But hey, you know, who's ever accused the government or our politicians of being honest? So the other way of paying for the high expense of a war is, well, let's just print off a bunch of money, and that way we can buy the bombs, and we can buy the guns, and we can buy the tanks. And the public, those rubes, will never know the difference. They'll never really know that we're stealing money from them to pay for this war. Yep, that's the plan. And that has been the plan for the last 60 years. How do you think we're paying for these wars without raising taxes to an alarming rate? Because if they raise the taxes to an exorbitant number, you would say, hey, maybe we should stop fighting the wars. But when they don't raise the taxes, and they secretly tax you, then you've got a lot of Americans like, well, you know, I guess we can fight the war. It seems like we can afford it. So when we have a war, 50%, and this is from Thomas Sowell, the example he gives. So 50% of the nation's output is going to go to the war. 50% of our factories, 50% of the resources will go to tanks, will go to food, will go to clothing. You name it, the different items that will go towards. So we're redirecting national resources and factories towards financing and producing the war. What we could do as a reasonable, rational, and honest government is raise taxes 50%. Take that money, use that money to buy the tanks, to buy the missiles, to buy the giant $2 billion drones, whatever we need. You take the money from the people, you literally steal it from their pocket through taxes, take that money and pay for the war. That's the honest way of doing it. But of course, that's not the way that we do business in the American government, because if people realized that was what was going on, we would stop paying for the wars. We would vote for different people that would no longer do this. If you made us pay and made us know that we were paying for the war, we would think twice about fighting the war. That's not what happens. So the government realizes, well, we really need this war thing to happen. And we know that taxing the people isn't an option. So let's just print a bunch of money. And we're going to show you how this is the same thing as taxing. They are taking your money just in a different way by printing more money and then spending that printed money on the war machine. They're taking your money. So 50% of output is going to go to the war. 50% of our resources in the country, our gross domestic products, will go toward the war. The rest will go to the people. Your groceries, your car, if you're lucky enough to have one during wartime. And just common sense here shows you that, well, if half of our resources are going to the war, then only half are going to the people. We have decreased supply because we diverted supply. Before, all the resources went to the public. 100% during peacetime go to the public, to our groceries, to our cars, to our homes, going down to the hammers, to the nails, to the clothing, to the jeans that we wear. Everything went to us. Now we've had to divert the resources towards the war, and only half are going to the people, so we have now decreased supply. Resources have become scarce, so we've decreased supply. But at the same time of decreasing supply during wartime, we have also increased the amount of money. We're printing more money to pay for the war. So we've decreased supply, that drives prices up. We're printing more money. And as we've talked about in the other inflation videos, when we print more money, people have more money. And when people have more money, they tend to spend more money. That increases demand. So we are decreasing supply, which raises prices. And we are increasing demand, which raises prices. This is a bad scenario. So we have a limited amount of resources. We have a scarce supply of resources. And we have people who have a lot of money because we printed it, and we've created auctions. We've created bidding wars on that finite supply of resources, which drives prices up. You have a limited supply of goods. You have a lot of people now with money and are capable to bid against each other for these goods, and that drives prices up, which basically is inflation. Inflation is the general rise in prices. And the government creates this by printing money. They're driving prices up. Now, in your head, in your brain, we often do not connect the rise in prices with the government's taking your money, right? We just see, well, inflation's just prices go up, you know, the dollar just doesn't buy what it used to. But you have to take that next step. The government has created a policy that has driven prices up. What driving prices up really means is you can buy less. You can buy less than you used to. Your dollar yesterday does not buy what it used to. Today, you cannot buy what you used to yesterday. And that's because of a government policy that's driven prices up. When prices go up, your dollar in the bank, it doesn't buy what it used to. You can no longer afford what you used to afford. You no longer can buy what you used to be able to buy because of government policy. The same thing as if I've got a dollar in my pocket and the government takes half of it through taxes, well, yeah, I can only buy half of what I could buy before the government came in, right? Let's rewind it. I got $100 in my pocket. Oh, the government taxes me. I only have $50. So now I can only buy $50 worth of goods. Whereas before the government taxed me, I could buy $100. They took $50 from me. Inflation is the same thing. You have $100 in your pocket. The government prints money, creates inflation, creates a rise in prices. So although I still have $100 in my pocket, I really cannot buy what I used to be able to buy because let's say I wanted to go buy a $100 cell phone, which is probably the worst phone ever, but whatever. Well, that $100 cell phone now is $150 because of inflation. The prices have increased. So I can no longer buy the phone that I used to be able to buy. And it's because of the government policy. So in a sense, they have stolen my wealth again. Let's look at it this way, 1960. Remember, a dollar could buy six times more stuff, or a dollar buys six times less stuff. Imagine you put $600,000 in the bank in 1960, and then you go back to the bank 60 years later, after the government has continued to print money and print money and print money because they're funding war after war after war, because they don't have the guts or the honesty or the decency to tell you that, yeah, we need to tax you to pay for this war. Instead of doing that, they just print more money to pay for the war. And so they've secretly, slowly but surely, over time, stolen that money from you. Basically, they've stolen your purchasing power. You will still go to the bank and take $600,000 out of the bank in 2019, but that $600,000 will not buy what it used to buy. It buys less because the government has slowly but surely taken the wealth from you. Instead of having the honesty to just say, give me half your paycheck, they say, well, no, you can keep all your money. But over here, we're secretly printing a bunch of money. So that paycheck that you see, it's not really worth what you think it is. Actually, that $600,000, you really only have $100,000. six times less stuff. We started the lesson saying here, because of inflation, a dollar buys six times less than it used to. So basically, if you put $600,000, you have a six times less purchasing power today. The government has robbed you of $500,000. They have robbed you of this wealth. It's a tax. Wake up. And not just to pick on war. We could also just pick on politicians, Medicare, Medicaid, you name the social service. If the government cannot afford to provide the service through taxes, then maybe they need to cut the service. And this is definitely a prescient topic considering where we are headed in the 2020 election with all the promises of free healthcare and free college. Sure, look, if the government wants to provide those services, free college and free healthcare, then they need to make sure that they can support it through taxes and have the decency and the honesty to raise the taxes to pay for the services that they're providing. But they should not pay for services while secretly taxing us by just printing more money. But that's what they're going to do, according to Thomas Sowell and basic economics, because that's what they've done, and that's what governments have done throughout time. By a continuing process of inflation, governments can confiscate secretly and unobserved an important part of the wealth of their citizens. This is John Maynard Keynes saying, the government is stealing your money. It makes taxes look honest. It makes us prefer taxing. Please, just tax me. Just take my money. Stick the gun in my face and take the money out of my wallet. They don't secretly print the money. And then I realize one day, yeah, all that money I saved over my entire life so that I could retire, it doesn't buy anything anymore. Imagine you are 70 years old. You've saved your money your whole life. And then you have found today that, guess what? All that money that I've saved, it's almost worthless. It's definitely worth less, but it's almost worthless. Let's give you, well, before we get to the extreme example, inflation is a hidden tax. The money that people have saved is robbed of part of its purchasing power, which is quietly transferred to the government that issues new money. The government quietly and secretly steals your money. Now, they're not taking dollars from your bank account, but when they print money, they spend the money on the stuff that they need. And slowly over time, as more and more money is printed, the money that you have in the bank just loses its purchasing power, slowly but surely. It is a hidden tax, and it's a tax on everyone. It's a tax on the poor. It's a tax on the rich. The poor pay this tax through the rise in prices of goods through inflation. So the poor pay this tax by having to spend more on goods, and they desperately can't afford to pay more on jeans, to pay more on healthcare, and to pay more on housing, to pay more on the food at the grocery, but they're forced to pay this tax. The rich pay this tax as well because the money that they put in the bank, it becomes worth less. Their purchasing power goes down. Now, it's not as bad on the wealthy because they can invest the money in stocks and they can invest the money in properties or like a yacht. And as inflation rises, so prices increase, so that yacht increases in value from $200,000 to $300,000. So it doesn't hit the rich as bad. It does hit them, but not as severely, but it definitely hits the poor. This is a bad tax for everyone. It's completely dishonest. That is what inflation is. Let's give you one of the most extreme examples of hyperinflation. Hopefully we're not headed in this route, but let's just show you how bad things get. 1920, 40 Deutschmarks equaled $1. Don't get hung up on the exchange rate. Don't worry about that. You'll understand it here in a second. So if you're like, well, is that good? Is that bad? Don't worry about that right now. What really matters is from 1920 to 1923, in 1920, 40 Deutschmarks exchanged for $1 bill. What do you think the exchange rate was in 1923? After the government started printing more money and more money because the government needed to print money to provide the services that they promised. The government needed money to pay for all these things that it wanted to do. Well, when you print a bunch of money, people spend more money, you increase demand, and demand shoots prices up, and it can be very extreme. That's how extreme. If you're not sure what that number is, I don't blame you. That is $4 trillion. It is such a big number, it doesn't even fit in the graphic I created. I gotta rewrite it as a word. That's how bad this number is. 40 to 1 to 4 trillion to 1. We can't even fathom. You can't even imagine how ridiculous that is. I mean, you've seen examples of kids playing with giant blocks of money as toys, right? Where they're stacking the money up. And people say, well, it's not even worth the paper it's printed on. It's almost worth less than the paper it's printed on. And we were upset that, well, 1960, I could get six times more stuff. 4 trillion to 40. 4 trillion to 40. And we're upset. We feel like, man, the government is stealing my money. I had $600,000. Now I have $100,000. 4 trillion. What is that like? 100 billion less stuff. 100 billion times less stuff it can buy. We were mad about six. Imagine saying, oh man, the government, you know, I used to be able to buy 199,999,999,960 more stuff. It's unfathomable. Imagine in 1920, you go in the bank like, I'm just going to deposit my $4 trillion, which is really impossible to think that who had 4 trillion Deutschmarks in 1920. But just bear with me for this example. This super rich guy puts in $4 trillion, and then just 3 years later, well, technically it'd be 4 years, but let's just say 3 years later, he walks in like, all right, I need my $4 trillion. Well, here's your 40 Deutschmarks. 40? Where is my 399,999,999,999,960 other Deutschmarks at? Yeah, it's gone. It's inflation. Well, technically, he would get 4 trillion back, but the 4 trillion would buy almost nothing. The 4 trillion would, you get the point. To like get an idea of how bad inflation, hyperinflation was in Germany, a comparison would be, imagine that we, through hyperinflation, turn Bill Gates or Jeff Bezos into a poor person. That's what, now what would happen to a poor person, right? If that's what happens to them, then we just die? I mean, there's gotta be something worse than death, right? If Bill Gates to a poor person, what is a poor person, right? Like how much poorer can they go? Well, they could be dead. It seems like dead's not deep enough down. I mean, like 7 layers of hell, is that the punishment? Is that the severity of the inflation? This is serious stuff. When the government prints money and people spend it because they should, and it creates prices that go really high, and the value of the dollar or the purchasing power just plummets, obviously the German people were pretty upset. 40 trillion to 40, pretty big deal. Kind of sets up a bad scenario, allows for this guy to have some power. And that starts with bad government policy through inflation, which is a hidden tax. They are taking your wealth and you do not even know it.